Good morning. Good to see all of you this morning, and those who are visiting with us, special welcome to you. Delighted you've joined us today. Some announcements before we begin our worship service. First of all, I've seen several of you carrying the book. We're doing a book study, so if you head into the fellowship hall, you'll find the books in the fellowship hall, and then the preaching series beginning in Lent on that book. Today is Super Bowl Sunday, and we're doing the soup kettles for Super Bowl Sunday, and so I think we're going to have some kids here for donations, so I hope you are generous, as those proceeds will go to our local food shelf, the Bridge Pantry. Next Sunday is lay visitor and communion training, and that's at 10 o'clock. Hope to see many of you. Willing to be a lay visitor and also give communion to people. And then another one also available next week, Thursday at noon, and we will provide lunch for that. So visitation training and communion training this next week. That's it for the announcements. Let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship. We gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done and by what we have left undone, we have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of yours, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Renew us and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to stand for our opening hymn. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. You may be seated. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the reign of God and for peace throughout the world, for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For your people here who have come to give you praise, for the strength to live your word, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, and defend us, O God. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, increase in us the gift of faith, hope, and love, and that we may obtain what you promise, and make us love what you command, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Wonderful, merciful. The Old Testament lesson is from the book of the prophet Jeremiah, chapter 1, verses 4 through 10, a reading from Jeremiah. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." Then I said, "Ah, Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy." But the Lord said to me, "Do not say, 'I am only a boy,' for you shall go to all to whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord." Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, "Now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and to pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant." The word of the Lord. The New Testament lesson is from the Apostle Paul's first lesson to the Corinthians, chapter 13, verses 1 through 13, a reading from 1 Corinthians. "If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith as to remove mountains but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but I do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, and the greatest of these is love. The word of the Lord.
I hear lots of little voices. Are there any kids that want to come up for the children's message, though? Pretty soon we're going to have Josie and Evelyn up there. So just a few more months. So will you please rise for the gospel acclamation? This morning's gospel lesson comes to us from the Gospel of St. Luke, the 4th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Then Jesus began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is this not Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, 'Doctor, cure yourself,' and you will say, 'Do here also in your hometown the things that we have heard you did at Capernaum.'" And he said, "Truly I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown. But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel in the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up for 3 years and 6 months, and there was a severe famine over all the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them, except to a widow at Zarephath in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them were cleansed except Naaman the Syrian." When they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up, drove him out of town, and led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Now, our scripture passage for this morning is a direct continuation of last week's reading, where we heard about Jesus' first public act of ministry in the Gospel of Luke. And I want to repeat the words that Jesus proclaimed, because it helps to set the stage for this morning's reading. So Jesus stood in the synagogue, and he unrolled the scroll of Isaiah, and he said these words, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to them, and sat down. And then he said to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." So in that first public act of ministry in Luke, Jesus reveals who he is, what he will do, and for whom he has come. And so these verses give us the framework for the way that we read the rest of the Gospel of Luke. So all of the teaching, all of the preaching, all of the interacting with people, even his death and resurrection, are through that lens. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, bringing good news to the poor, proclaim release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And for us, followers of Jesus, that gives us the frame for which we view our life and our work. So proclaim release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And if that feels like a lot of words to remember, well, here at Calvary, we say it with just 6 words. Thank God, share Jesus, help others. And we know that those 6 words get lived out in so many different ways. Each of us bring our unique gifts and abilities, and together we do so much to live out our faith. But I think that sometimes we're quick to skip to the what of faith. Well, what should we do? But instead, Jesus invites us to slow down and to go deeper. In one of his books, Pastor John Ortberg says this: the most important task of your life is not what you do, but who you become. And God made you to flourish, and those who flourish always bring blessing to others. Now, there are lots of different markers we could use if we're going to talk about what it looks like to flourish. Pastor Ortberg talks about it living in the Spirit, and he talks about the Spirit as we hear in Galatians, the gifts of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. I think our baptismal promises are also markers that we can see that. So we talk about how we do all the things that we do in faith. So we trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others in the world God made, and work for justice and peace. Now, as I was thinking about this scripture, it's a little bit different for us. Since we switched from the narrative lectionary a couple years ago back to the Revised Common, normally we hear the scripture every 3 years, but since we were in narrative, we actually heard it 2 years ago. And so think back to 2 years ago. Where were we then? It was January 2017. We were 6 months into our interim, our quick, short little interim that was going to go so fast, right? So we were discerning, who are we as a faith community? Who is going to be a leader that can walk alongside us? And as we thought those things, we wondered, what are our values? How do we best live out our calling? Who are we as a faith community? And in these last 2 years, we have changed, but yet at the same time, we're still us. We're still working to be a community of faith that flourishes. And so as we have our ministry now with Pastor Paul alongside us, we find ourselves asking many of those same questions. What are our values? How do we best live out our calling? Who are we as a faith community? And so that's perhaps a little plug for the book, Renewing Your Congregation, Living Lutheran, that we are going to be reading and talking about through Lent. It's going to help us dig into those sorts of questions. And I use that word dig intentionally because dig is an active word. It's a word that's work. And it is work. The work of becoming the person and the community that God created us to be. I mean, it can be challenging. It's going to continually stretch us. We're going to work to be who God created us to be. Which brings us back to our gospel lesson for this morning. So Jesus makes this proclamation of who he is and for whom he has come. And the people love him and they welcome him until we get to today's reading. And he speaks some more about how God's love doesn't create insiders and outsiders, but rather all are welcome. And then it says this: and all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up, drove him out of town, and led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off a cliff. Now, this is not to say that the work of becoming who God created you to be might mean that you too might be thrown off a cliff, but rather it means we're going to have to work, we're going to be stretched, we're going to be challenged. But to understand what's going on and with Jesus and this crowd, we need to talk a little bit about how this community understood salvation. So for this community, and in the Gospel of Luke, salvation is understood primarily in social terms. So in Luke, we hear that salvation is a reversal of the social order. Blessed are the poor, but woe to the rich. Blessed are the hungry, but woe to the filled. And so Jesus challenges the crowd that he's speaking to, a crowd that has experienced a division of insiders and outsiders, and they find themselves what they believe to be on the inside, but they hear from Jesus that he's going to break down divisions. There won't be any more insiders and outsiders. And the thing about that is insiders and outsiders created comfort and security. And so he's not just saying all are welcome, but rather what's comfortable and secure for you may be no more. God's radical love and grace includes all. So what does that mean for us? It seems to mean that our journey, our work to become the people that God created us to be, isn't really a journey with ourselves at the center. It's not a curving inward or navel-gazing, as Luther would have called it. But rather, this work of becoming the people that God created us to be is a work that puts God at the center and puts us in relationships with others. So God's blessing and God's work comes to us, and then it goes through us to others. So how might God's blessing come to you and then through you during this season? Thanks be to God. Amen.
Invite you to stand if you're able. And let us now profess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come and judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the people of God in Christ Jesus and for the whole human family and all of creation. We pray for the church. Inspire us by your Spirit as we respond to your call. When we are reluctant, strengthen us. When we are doubtful, encourage us. Above all, let your love shine through us. Lord, in your mercy. For the earth, for mountains and prairies, cities and farms, rainforests and deserts, awaken us to the mystery and diversity of your creation. Nurture all living things and protect your creation from harm. Lord, in your mercy. For the nations, kindle within us a spirit of respect for one another. Protect those fleeing their homes to escape danger or oppression. Bring peace to communities torn apart by warfare and violence. Lord, in your mercy. For those in need, protect those who suffer abuse and encourage those who lack hope. Guide all who provide medical care. Comfort those who grieve and bring healing to the sick. Lord, in your mercy. For this assembly, bless our children, our elders, gather us into a community guided by your love. Inspire in us a spirit of hospitality and kindness. Teach us to bear one another's burdens with compassion. Lord, in your mercy. We give thanks for those who have gone before us in faith and who now see you face to face. Inspire us by their example and bring us into your everlasting presence. Lord, in your mercy. Receive our prayers and fill us with the radiance of your love through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. I would invite you to share the peace with your neighbor. You may be seated, and we will receive the offering at this time. Let us pray. Merciful God, everything in heaven and on earth belongs to you. We joyfully release what you have entrusted to us. And may these gifts be signs of our whole lives returned to you, dedicated to the healing and unity of all creation through Jesus Christ. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is our duty and our delight that we should everywhere and always offer thanks and praise to you, O God, through Jesus Christ, who is your light made manifest to all nations. And so with the church on earth and all creation and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. You are indeed holy, gracious, and merciful God. Everything is filled with your glory. We give you thanks for your promise and presence, which have sustained the faithful in this and every generation. Above all, we give you thanks for Jesus, born of Mary, who in word and deed announced your gentle rule of justice, reconciliation, and peace. On the night of his betrayal, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for them to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Remembering his command to love one another, his death and life, his resurrection and his ascension, we pray for his coming again, even as we cry.
Amen, come, Lord Jesus. Amen, come, Lord Jesus.
Send now, we pray, your Holy Spirit, that all of your promises may come to us and your whole creation.
Amen, come, Holy Spirit. Amen, come, Holy Spirit.
And this we pray through Jesus Christ, our Savior and friend. Make us bold, O merciful God, to address you as Abba as we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. So for communion this day, we commune with individual cups. We will commune at the railing as well. For gluten-free, we have gluten-free on this side. And the gluten-free wafers are in the center. If you would please let the servers know. Come, for all things are ready.